That's quite a flock of future gardeners that we just saw there. Thanks so much for sharing your garden with us. Right now we're going to be talking about tree care, and I'm joined by Mark Mann, who's a certified arborist and manager with Davey Tree. Welcome to Central Texas Gardener.
Thanks for having me, Tom. I really appreciate being here. It's always fun to talk about trees.
It is. I'm a tree person. This is one of my favorite topics. We're going to start by talking about oak wilt, which is not a happy topic to talk about.
No, sir.
But we're talking at the right time of year. This is midwinter.
Yes, sir.
And for pruning on the trees, this is really the ideal time.
This is a great time of year. Tom, during oak wilt season, the fungus likes nice mild weather just like we like nice mild weather. So springtime, it starts growing and the risk of disease transmission is really high. It varies area to area, and a lot of local municipalities have ordinances against pruning during the springtime and into early summer. But we big thing, we want to prune when it's really hot or really cold. The disease doesn't spread that often. So pruning when it's dormant, especially if you have to prune a decent amount of live foliage off the tree, best time of year to do it.
And when you have a tree that's large, to call a certified arborist. But a lot of homeowners are anxious to get, you know, some limbs taken care of on their own. What are some of the precautions they can take?
So when we prune little trees, especially what a homeowner can do, we recommend sterilizing the tools. Some people recommend a bleach water solution. We use a generic bactericide that can kill fungal spores. And just sterilize the tools so you don't bring spores from somewhere else.
Right.
And then when we make wounds on oak trees, we want to paint them immediately, about anything pinky nail size and larger, quarter to half inch diameter. It's just blocks the smell of the sap attracting the insect that spreads the disease. You don't need thick, tarry pruning seal.
Right.
We use cheap black spray paint. That's just kind of what people like to use locally. You can use pink, purple, whatever you want, but it blocks the smell of the sap that attracts the insect. So that's what we'd recommend.
Okay, I don't think I'd go for purple, but there you go.
Probably not. I've seen it.
Okay, very good. You can work on oak trees at other times if you take proper precautions.
You can, definitely. It's not advisable because the risk is much higher for spreading the disease during that time, but sometimes limbs break in a storm or someone moves to a new house and the trees are rubbing on my roof line, or we see a branch that poses a safety hazard. That needs to be addressed, but professionals and homeowners can do it on their own, but professionals will make sure to sterilize those tools and properly seal the wound at the right time.
Well, we all care about our oak trees. They're the dominant tree species in Central Texas. Is there anything we can do preventively to help them?
Preventively, we love to do deep root fertilization for trees. Different brands, different companies do it different ways. Homeowners can do some things themselves as well, but deep root fertilization is the most effective way of getting it efficiently to the roots. It can also help aerate the soil a little bit, water the roots at that time, and it breaks down in a controlled manner to kind of mimic naturally what good forest soils do on controlled nutrient release to the roots.
So. And you know, deep root can be done now or into the springtime.
Yes, sir. So deep root can be done with a slow release fertilizer any time of the year. You're not going to overload the tree and drive stringy, weak growth off the tree that'll be susceptible to insects.
Sure.
We don't want to overload the tree with fertilizer in the summer when it's hot. But if you do slow release, you can do it any time of the year. If it's a quick release, shoot for spring or fall and avoid winter when it's dormant or summer when it's hot and can stress the tree out.
And what we were just talking about, that's really great advice for established trees, right?
And then
for new trees, I usually tend to tell people fertilize it in the springtime.
It's a good time because it's directly, depending on the formulation of the fertilizer, it's directly affecting that season's growth and helping them get a head start as they're establishing into that new landscape.
Yeah. Well, that's something proactive, talking about the fertilization stuff, that's something that a lot of homeowners can do. They can also contract with folks for the deep root stuff. But there's another problem I wanted to bring up, and that is animals actually girdling trees or damaging trees. And here in Central Texas, that could mean squirrels. It could also mean deer cleaning the velvet off their antlers.
Correct. Definitely. They can cause big problems. And it's more the physical damage to the tree tissue that blocks, it disrupts the water and nutrient flow from the roots through the stem out to the tip. So if we generally tell people, if you have much more than 20 or 30% of the circumference of a limb chewed up, you're going to start having some issues or potential for injury, decay, and weakness in a storm of that limb. But when the limbs die, that's when the squirrel or other rodent or deer completely damage the outside edge of the tree, and water and nutrients just can't get up there, so it browns out and dies.
Yeah, you know, in deer country, you can cage trees, which is really advised, right?
I mean, you can certainly do that. Depends on how many, whether that's practical, but you can physically keep them away. There are some products that can be repellents. Their efficacy is hit or miss, depending on which product, how it's applied. You can ask professional kind of wildlife control companies about that, but they certainly can cause some damage to our trees.
And I've tried some really crazy products, you know, over the years.
It's worth a shot.
To just scare, especially the squirrels away.
Yes, sir.
I haven't been very successful with that.
And it's not always just the damage to the trees, but if you're trying to keep them from being up in the canopy or getting over to a dwelling or a building, you know, there's some other things to think about.
Yeah.
So they can be challenging to work with.
Okay, so, you know, another issue that a lot of people are concerned about here in Central Texas, I'm just now learning about this, but there's a fungal disease, or excuse me, a scale insect that is affecting crape myrtles. And in our neighbor cities up north, like Dallas-Fort Worth, it's already impacting them. It's called crape myrtle bark scale.
Yes, sir.
And it sounds like a nightmare scenario in a town with like 10 million crape myrtle trees in it.
We do have a lot of crape myrtles. People love those blooms, and it's a nasty critter. People are used to the aphids, the little white insects on the leaves. Crape myrtle bark scale lives on the bark. It's a larger, whitish insect that forms a hard covering, and they're hard to deal with, and they can suck higher volumes of sap from the plant, so they can cause more significant damage quicker. They still secrete honeydew from what they feed,
and
you get it's sugary water that comes out their hind end and causes issues and gets sticky on cars, all that fun stuff.
Right.
But similar to an aphid, can cause more damage, and they take some significant control measures to line out.
Can't just use insecticide soap.
You can. There are some recommendations through the Agriculture Extension Services, but you can wash it as a homeowner with soap and water with a brush, or you can use systemic insecticides, whether injected into the soil or drenched at the base of the plant, that suck up through the tissue so you don't have to spray it up in the air or deal with the timing of what stage the insects are in. So one systemic insecticidal treatment for the crape myrtles per year can really help them out with the crape myrtle bark scale, but other methods are available in planting other non-susceptible species. Sometimes a good alternative as well to mix it up a bit.
Yeah, well, and you speak of planting, we only have just a few seconds, but to folks out there who are going to be in the nurseries this spring, they're going to be looking for trees, you know, that trigger gets flipped.
Right.
What's the number one thing they should look for in terms of a healthy tree?
Healthy tree, we want to make sure that you've got well-spaced branches. They can check the base. That's sometimes hard with not formal training, but you can check the base of the tree. We like nice bell-bottom jeans at the base. The trunk needs to flare out a bit. If it looks like a telephone pole stuck in the soil, you may have root issues at the base. So.
All right. Well, Mark, that's terrific. Thank you so much for coming
Thank
on
you.
The program.
My pleasure.
You've been a great guest. And again, we really appreciate having you on the show.
Thank you very much.
All right. And coming up next is Daphne.